be celebrations and a military parade in the Bangladeshi capital next week. They're marking the 40th anniversary of the day the Pakistani army surrendered to the Indian army in Dhaka. It meant Pakistan had lost its eastern wing and Bangladesh was born. Mark Tully recalls reporting from that country in the early stages of the 10-month-long uprising by the Mukti Bahini, the self-styled Bengali freedom fighters. He believes that a realistic assessment of what happened 4 decades ago could prevent the celebrations adding to the legacy of bitterness left by Pakistan's humiliation.
I was in the first party of journalists to be allowed to travel freely in the then East Pakistan after the army crackdown started. By this time, the army had regained control over all the major towns, but evidence of the crackdown remained. Dhaka was silent and surly, with normally crowded streets remarkably empty. In the university, rockets had blasted halls of residence, and a police barracks had been heavily shelled. Driving west from Dhaka, I saw the results of the scorched earth policy the army had adopted to establish control over the countryside and restore communications. All along the highway, roadside villages had been burnt and were deserted. I entered one small town where the bazaar had been set ablaze and the entire population appeared to have fled. Everywhere I went, the army and the Punjabi police, brought in from West Pakistan to enforce martial law, were very much in evidence. I experienced the bitterness between Bengalis and Punjabis when a Punjabi policeman arrested me for taking photographs. At the police station, the Bengali officer in charge berated the Punjabi, saying, "You people come to our country, you can't speak our language, you don't know our customs, you don't even understand the orders of your own government. These journalists are allowed to photograph whatever they like." Major Sadiq Salik, the Pakistan Army public relations officer, tall and formidable with his close-cropped black hair, neat military moustache and narrow eyes, managed to keep tabs on our every move. We also had regular briefings from the suave Major General Rao Farman Ali, who was in charge of the civil administration. He maintained there was no question of a political solution to the uprising. The answer had to be military. Although the army had restored control and was meeting little resistance, operations were continuing in the form of what were called sweep operations and clearing operations. The former were house searches, the latter were full-scale military operations against areas where there were reports that the Mukti Bahini rebels had gathered. Field guns and mortars were used in these clearing operations. Salik wrote a book called Witness to Surrender when he eventually got back to Pakistan after 2 years in an Indian prisoner of war camp. In it, he quoted a fellow officer who'd conducted a clearing operation based on faulty information as saying, "Only poor country folk, mostly women and old men, got roasted in the barrage of fire. I'll carry this burden on my conscience for the rest of my life." When I read Salik's book, I discovered that General Rao Farman Ali didn't believe in a military solution and had, in fact, been pressing for an amnesty, but was told the time for politics is over. It probably was. In the months that followed, it became more and more clear that India was keeping the pot boiling with its support for the Mukti Bahini and was planning a full-scale invasion. The Mukti Bahini's record was scarred by atrocities committed against supporters of the government. The Pakistan Army raised some 50,000 volunteers known as Razakas and gave them a license to kill. Undoubtedly, Pakistan's reliance on a military solution to the uprising in its eastern wing is largely to be blamed for those blood-stained months. However, if Bangladesh and India openly accepted that right wasn't entirely on their side, then they might avoid celebrating this 40th anniversary triumphantly and pouring salt on Pakistan's wounded pride. Unfortunately, countries rarely behave like that, so the celebrations will only serve to remind Pakistanis of their humiliation, which will do nothing to mitigate the bitterness and suspicion that characterizes relations between the countries of South Asia.
Mark Tully there.